end of the day, we're all dreamers. We're dreamers who aspire to break through any barricades that life sets up for us. An individualized set of dreams is implemented within each and every person, a predisposition to set the person up to aim for a certain life. However, humans are vulnerable, and this vulnerability often is what destroys the dreams that make us. We're all weak products placed in a somewhat protective box with open windows. These windows are made of flimsy plastic that is far too easy to break through. And sometimes, the packaging that protects us is plastered with labels that prevent us from seeing the beauty of the external world. These labels are an alternate form of darkness, whether they appear as humans or other forms. The prevalence of these labels cause intruding thoughts to bombard the mind of the individual. These labels cause torment. They colonize within every neuron of the mind, tainting each and every memory to the point that the individual no longer wants to think. In order to think, the individual must eat, sleep, and feel. I guess that even those basic functions are challenged with the arrival of an external colonizer. In The Bell Jar by Sylvia Plath, Esther Greenwood is subject to the detriment of herself. Her mind slowly becomes plagued with parasitic thoughts. Her mind becomes colonized by depression. At the beginning of Esther's journey, she was living quite the lavish life. She had been selected to be a guest editor for a fashion magazine in New York. She had access to all the clothing she could ever wish for, and she was consistently attending luxurious dinners and events. The first stage of depression is referred to as the denial stage. The first stage includes apathy, lack of desire to perform any action, fatigue, as said by Undepressed. This is extremely prevalent in Esther's life. She describes what she's experiencing on page 12. Only I wasn't steering anything, not even myself. I just bumped from my hotel to work and to parties, and from parties to my hotel and back to work like a numb trolley bus. I guess I should have been excited the way most of the other girls were, but I couldn't get myself to react. I felt very still and very empty, the way the eye of a tornado must feel, moving dully along in the middle of a surrounding hullabaloo. This marks the initial colonization of the depression in her mind. Internally, the colonizers in her mind demotivated her to the point that she was hollowed out. Her previously bubbly personality was discarded. She wasn't truly living. Her physical self was moving out and about, completing tasks that her society expects her to complete. She became a puppet, the depression slowly gaining control over her life to the point that she feels alienated from the rest of the world. Sylvia Plath may have chosen to emphasize the fact that Esther was living a glamorous life. Her body was embellished with patent leather and jewels in order to prove that decay is a process that is not only and always externally evident. The second stage of depression is marked by the dissonance of the internal organs. The individual cannot eat or sleep or even get out of bed. Esther is plummeted into the stage quite rapidly. On page 119, Esther says, "I feigned sleep until my mother left for school, but even my eyelids didn't shut out the light. They hung the raw red screen of their tiny vessels in front of me like a wound. I crawled between the mattress and the padded bedspread and let the mattress fall across me like a tombstone. It felt dark and safe under there, but the mattress was not heavy enough. It needed about a ton more weight to make me sleep." This is the first regard to her inability to fall asleep, the first sign of the depression not only colonizing her mind, but now her body. Esther could no longer function as she was once able to. On page 122, she says, "I was still wearing Betsy's white blouse and drindle skirt. They drooped a bit now, as I hadn't washed them in my 3 weeks at home. The sweaty cotton gave off a sour but friendly smell. I hadn't washed my hair for 3 weeks either. I hadn't slept for 7 nights." She begins to prefer darkness above all else. On page 122, she says, "At first I wondered why the room felt so safe. Then I realized it was because there was no windows. Just like bacteria, the depressed colony needs darkness to thrive. It probably pursues the quote by Martin Luther King Jr. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that." The third stage marks the most dangerous stage. The individual loses the ability to control their behavior and their emotions, often leading to acting on suicidal thoughts. Almost all individuals in this stage require hospitalization. Initially, Esther sees Dr. Gordon, who is of no assistance to her case. He uses shock treatment on her, which she absolutely despises. After this, she stops attending Dr. Gordon's therapy sessions. She attempts to run away with the intention of committing suicide. She acts on the colony's wishes and consumes 50 of her antidepressant pills all at once in an attempt to end her life. She ends up in an asylum where the doctors are able to closely monitor her. A big thanks goes out to UnDepress for educating our faculty on the three stages of depression in order to ensure the validity of our analysis. Okay, so now we're going to be discussing how Esther Greenwood had to conform to a lifestyle as a colonizer herself. So I predominantly consider Esther to be the land in which the empire of mental illness colonizes upon. However, it seems as though Esther considers her own self to be a colonizer. She believes that she is trapped in a bell jar, the bell jar being filled with darkness. Thus, she indicates that she colonized the jar despite her intentions. On page 173, she says, "If Miss Guinea had given me a ticket to Europe or a round-the-world cruise, it wouldn't have made one scrap of a difference to me, because wherever I sat, on the deck of a ship or at a street cafe in Paris or Bangkok, I would just be sitting under the same glass bell jar, stewing in my own sour air." She describes the contents of the bell jar on page 217. "To the person in the bell jar, blank and soft as a dead baby, the world itself is the bad dream." She refers to the bell jar as a place, again indicating that this is a place that she can be residing in. Aside from essentially colonizing a mental illness, she colonizes a cultural niche, the fashion magazine niche. Initially, she would have been marginalized in this colony for not knowing how to conform to its rules, as exemplified on page 45. "Mrs. Guinea answered my letter and invited me to lunch at her home. That was where I saw my first finger bowl. The water had a few cherry blossoms floating in it, and I thought it must be some clear sort of Japanese after-dinner soup, and ate every bit of it, including the crisp little blossoms. Mrs. Guinea never said anything, and it was only much later, when I told a debutante I knew at college about the dinner, and that I learned what I had done." She eventually conformed to the expectations of the colony and dressed herself in luxurious clothing. She attended dinner parties and went out with the other girls from the fashion magazine. Esther, however, is entirely capable of resisting colonization, especially when that colonization is under the realms of love. Esther does not want a man to colonize her heart, as seen with her primary love interest, Buddy Willard. On page 83, she expresses her distaste for marrying someone. "That's one of the reasons I never wanted to get married. The last thing I wanted was infinite security and to be the place an arrow shoots off from." She had casually been dating Buddy Willard for many years, but she refused to genuinely love him. Buddy Willard was a hypocrite, as she said on page 56, due to the fact that he casually talks about having an affair with a waitress for an entire summer. To Esther, this characteristic of Buddy causes her to refrain from truly ever loving him. She refuses to let him get so close to her so that he is capable of colonizing her. Although mental illnesses can be viewed as the heinous empire that overpowered Esther's life, Esther is the true empire. Each aspect of her personality, her poetry, her ability to love, her happiness, her sadness, her wit, are different colonies that each contribute to her empire. Each colony establishes as the result of her life experiences and personal growth. Depression starts off as a colony that burrows itself within her empire and then eventually becomes an imperialist colony that overthrows all other colonies. Thank you for listening, and for more information on the bell jar, visit my blog, Allison Islands. If you or a loved one is struggling with depression, please do not hesitate to contact the Canadian Association for Suicide Prevention.